Good morning.
Hello. 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 Check.
Jason.
Check. Grace, yeah. Hello.
Hello. Check. Check. One, two. Check. 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 Hello.
Good morning, everybody. How is your growth going? We love our youth here at Duck Church. It is a little bit itchy. How do y'all men folk do this for real? All right, we're going to glorify the Lord with our facial hair and our singing this morning. How about it?
Woo-hoo.
Awesome. Let's stand up together. I got to move this or it's going to distract me. It'll stay right there. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can have joy in this place this morning because you are with us. And we pray that our singing and our clapping would be something that glorifies you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Let's sing. Let's put our hands together.
Searching for
sit down for just a second. We're in the season of Lent in the Christian year, and Lent is a time when we focus on penitence, which is a big churchy word for realizing the places where we fall short of what God wants for our lives, and then saying to God, we know that we fall short, and we are asking for your forgiveness, Lord, and we want to turn away from those things. We want to repent and turn back to God. So in light of the season that we're in and the song we're going to sing next, I just want to invite you into a time of personal silent reflection, just to share what it is with God that you feel like you're falling short in this week, and then we'll sing about God's forgiveness. Let's pray silently. So sorry for the ways that we don't live up to your standard. Thank you for your word that shows us how we're called to live and then points out the places that we need to be made new. And we're grateful for your grace and that you say in your word that when we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So God, we ask you to cleanse us this morning, to make us new, to fill us with your grace, to forgive, and also to transform us to become more like Jesus. We pray this in your name, Lord. Amen. Let's stand and sing. Lord, we don't pretend to be perfect. We know that you accept us as we are, but you don't want to leave us that way. So God, we just ask that you would change us to make us new, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Take a second and greet the folks standing around you.
Thank you for asking. What a difference a weekend makes, right?
Yeah.
Last weekend was a fun weekend for the Carolina fans. Yeah. Yeah. This was a good weekend for the Duke fans.
Yeah.
If we could go back to the 70s, right? Like my mustache is taking us back to the 70s. There you go. Speaking of which, you'll notice a lot of the guys are growing a little something, and that's because of our March fundraiser for the youth to grow something and get you to vote for the mustache that you want to vote for, the beard you want to vote for. So if you just put a little something on your envelope that says who you're voting for, it'll go for Amy's mustache. There you go. That's it. That's it. That's really fun. Did it? I noticed it just sprouted right up. I'm saying, yeah, you got it. Let's see. I want to invite the kids to come up. Come on up, kids, if you'd like to. I bet you'd like to see these quilts up close. Come on up. Yeah. These are quilts that people in our church made for children that are maybe sick or very sad. Come on, walk around and you can look at them. You want to? You can touch them. You want to? Here's a girl with a sunflower. This one with birds. Ah, airplanes. I like that. Football, baseball. Yeah. Oh, look, that's cute. Is that Mother Goose and lambs? You know what kind of dog that is? That's a dachshund there. And that's a Dalmatian. What's that?
Elephant.
Elephant. What's that?
Tiger.
There you go. Let's see.
I got those
corgi
dogs.
Do you?
Yeah.
Come on around. Yep. Yeah, it's nice to see these up close, isn't it? Feel them? Wasn't it nice of the ladies to make these? Yeah. Come on, let's sit down. Yeah, you know, one of the ways that we show our love for God is finding ways to show love for other people, and these ladies made these quilts to show their love for children that are in need. That's really cool, isn't it? Yeah. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for these beautiful quilts. We thank you for all the different ways that we find to show how much we love you and love our neighbors. We pray that you bless these children here, that their homes would be places where they learn more and more about Jesus by what gets said there and what gets done there. And we pray that you'll bless them with fullness of joy. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you like a piece of candy? Yeah, pick something out. There you go. There you go. Thanks for coming up. Sally Maher is the power behind the quilt making. Sally gets that group of folks together every year, and it seems like they do more and more glorious things every year. And Sally, we thank you for your leadership with this group. Come on up and tell us a little bit about it.
Okay, we have a little video. We'll show you, thanks to Amy, how we put these quilts together. That's a little snapshot of what we do on Fridays in January and February. We gather here and ladies come and do show and tell, which is always exciting to show what you have made and other people can appreciate it. Everyone then picks fabric, takes a pattern, we do a new pattern each week, and goes home and sews. And most of them will bring the quilt back the next week. These quilts are in local fire trucks, ambulance, police. They go to the shelter. We had 50 this year that went to a church in Richmond that has an outreach program, prison ministry. They take children to visit a parent who is incarcerated. Another 200 went to Louisiana Parish in Louisiana at the time of the flood there. The school was completely flooded and all the children were able to take one of our quilts. Some stay locally, some are just for individuals. If you know of a child who needs one, or you can get one at any time. This year we made 365, one for each day of the year, but we had a special program in September where we all got together with our sewing machines and had a one-day quilt-a-thon. We had prepackaged kits that someone had put together, and we just stitched the tops. So in that one day, we made 71 tops, and then finished them off during the year. So that's added to what we have here. There are a couple of the ladies who are here. I'll ask them to stand now, and then John will give a little blessing on the quilts. Is that it?
Yeah. Thank y'all for making these quilts. Gosh, that's such a loving, kind thing to do. It always surprises me that you're able to let go of them. You know, when you create something that's a work of art and then you give it away, that's a lot of love. Everybody, will you extend a hand towards some quilts and let's bless them. Lord, we thank you for all these quilts. We thank you for your love in the heart of the people that made them. We pray that that love would communicate to the children and their families who receive them. We pray that as they're wrapped with the warmth of these quilts, that they would feel your loving nearness with them, and that they would be reminded of the goodness of the body of Christ, the church. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Sally. Your generosity makes all these ministries possible. Thank you so much. If you would let the ushers come forward and we'll receive the morning tithes and offerings.
We're choosing celebration, breaking into freedom. You're the song of our hearts. We cast aside our shadows, trust you with our sorrows. You're the song of our hearts. To the rhythm of your heart, we're rising from the ashes to the stars. You're the joy, 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 light in my soul. The joy, 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 making me whole, though I'm broken. I am running into your arms. Oh, joy, making me whole though I'm broken. I am running into your arms, of love, into your arms.
That was fun. Thank you. The text comes from John chapter 19, beginning with verse 25. Would you stand for the reading of the gospel? Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. That's at the end of the ministry of Jesus, right? Now I want to read something from the beginning of the ministry of Jesus. Jesus had just started his ministry. There were lots of crowds following him, and his family was concerned. They thought he had made a bad choice. And so we've got Mark chapter 3, beginning with verse 20. Then he went home, and the crowd came together again so that they could not even eat. So many people were coming to Jesus for ministry that he and the disciples couldn't even eat. When his family heard it, they went out to restrain him because people were saying he's gone mad. Then his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they said to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, "Your mother and your brothers and your sisters are outside asking for you." And he replied, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" And looking at those who sat around him, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So you're picturing Mary here at the crucifixion of Jesus. What might be going through her mind? We remember back to the birth of Jesus, and we remember that she gets it that Jesus is the Son of God. She gets it that Jesus is the Messiah. She gets that, right? Okay. But she probably does not understand that he's going to be crucified. She probably doesn't understand that. She knows that he's to be the savior of his people. She knows that he's to be the Messiah. But you know what Messiah means? It means the anointed one, the king, the chosen king that's going to be the redeemer of all Israel. And so she would have reason to be thinking kingship thoughts. Kingship thoughts. Now, granted, there is in the joy of his birth and in the announcement of his birth, there's this thread of angst woven in, right? Like, when the three kings come, they bring gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And of course, the gold speaks to his kingship and also probably came in really handy when they had to refugee out to Egypt. Interesting, isn't it, that the Holy Family were refugees, just by the way. Aren't we glad they were treated with hospitality in Egypt? Did they get a passport? I don't know. So the Holy Family fled to Egypt because they weren't safe at home. The gold, maybe that helped finance the trip. Don't know. So there's also the frankincense. Incense is a sign of his deity, his divinity. And then myrrh is like, I mean, it's a burial spice. That would be if you went to a christening party and you took along a little embalming fluid as a special gift for the mother. You know? It'd be a little odd, don't you think? You might not be invited back to the first birthday if you do that. Yeah. So it would be an awful lot like bringing embalming fluid as a gift. It was associated with preparing bodies for burial. So even in Jesus' birth, there's this note of foreboding in this glorious tide of anthem. Well, you get to the ministry of Jesus, and you can feel that Mary is anxious for her son. And so Jesus is in the middle of this really important time of ministry. It's a wonderful time. It's in beautiful sunny Galilee. People are flocking to him for healing and for teaching. But Mary is anxious for Jesus. And Mary realizes that some people are not talking well about him. Some people are saying he's lost his mind. Some people are saying he's demon-possessed. You know how gossip is. Yeah. And so Jesus' family go with him to sort of capture him, to get him, and to say, come on, son, I know you're excited, you know, and everything, but maybe it'd be better just to come on home with us now. Don't you think, son? Get back to the carpenter shop. You liked it there, didn't you? You know? So that's what the family of Jesus has got in mind. And so Jesus goes, they go to Jesus to do that, and Jesus just kind of like, oh, really? My family's out here? Well, that's really cool. But let me tell you, my family are those who do the will of God. Those are my mother, my sisters, and my brothers. Those who do the will of God. What's going on here? Well, I think one of the things that we see lived out here in the life of Jesus, and by the way, we're using Jesus as a pattern today, right? One of the things we see lived out here in the life of Jesus is the beautiful point and counterpoint of managing family life. It's not easy. It's not easy to manage family life, is it? Jesus' family thinks he should be doing something else, like as a career, than what he's doing. They think he should be doing something else, and they feel pretty strongly about it. And Jesus has a calling from God that he apprehends with great clarity. And he says, you know, Mama, I love you. You know I do. But this is what my life is about. And he won't stand down on that. One of the applications that I see in this scripture for you and me is sometimes God calls us to do things and our family doesn't agree. Sometimes that's reasonably small, like you feel like God is calling you to be a youth counselor with our youth group, or maybe teach Sunday school. Maybe you feel like God is calling you to give something that you haven't given before. Maybe you feel like God is calling you to do some ministry that you haven't done before. And maybe your spouse is kind of like, really? Are you going to do that? Right? Or, you know, maybe in your family, there's some kind of like pushback. Well, I got a question for you. Is this something God is calling you to do? Now, you need to discern that reasonably clearly. But if this is something God is calling you to do, then one of the things that Jesus teaches us really clearly is we put our family first. Oops, I just said that wrong. Exactly wrong. We put God first. We put God first. You know, one of the things that I really like to do is I like to help people prioritize their values. And most people have somewhere around 5 or 10 core values in their life. And it's probably true for you, like your relationship with God, your relationship with your family, your relationship with your friends, your health, your finances, maybe what you do for a calling, a career, or a job. These are some basic values that all of us have, but the question is, how do they rank order? What comes first? Do you put your family first? A lot of people do. Or do you put God first? A lot of people don't. One of the things that Jesus teaches us and the scriptures teach us over and over is you put God first and then everything else falls into place the way it's supposed to. So if you discern that God is leading you to do something, you want to be pretty sure that this really is a leading from God. But if it is, then you need to follow through on it. Because when you're obedient to God, everything else in your life is put in proper proportion and is in its proper place. Mary meant well, but God had put a special call on Jesus' life that he had discerned. And so it is sometimes with our family, sometimes with our kids. Our kids feel a pull and a call to do something that we might disagree with, right? Sometimes we are the ones that feel a pull and a call to do something that our kids might disagree with. So the first thing that I see here is be responsible to doing what God is calling you to do. And if your kids are telling you they feel a call, support them. Support them in what they feel called to do. That's what Mary does. We notice in the scripture that although Mary wanted to kind of segue Jesus out of this public ministry because she thought it was dangerous, what a good protective mother. Seems dangerous, son. We notice that as Jesus persists in his ministry, she catches up with him, follows, goes with him, and supports him. And so here she is at the foot of the cross as Jesus is dying. She might be thinking something like, I knew it, I knew it, I knew it, I knew this was not going to end well. If only you had listened to me. She might be thinking that. Who knows what Mary is thinking? Because Mary probably does not have God's long-haul view of what's going on. No one is expecting Jesus to be raised from the dead on Sunday morning. You get it? not even Mary. Second thing I want to bring up to you is what Jesus does in preparing for his death. What Jesus does in preparing for his death. Jesus, no doubt, has spoken to John, the beloved disciple. We like to make fun of the fact that John calls himself the disciple whom Jesus loved, right? That's always, you know, sort of amusing. And then there was also the disciple whom Jesus loved. But Jesus and John clearly have a special relationship because it's John that he goes to take care of his mama. It's John that he goes to take care of that very special relationship. And he goes to his mama, no doubt, and says, "Mama, it looks like this is getting close to the end. And if that happens, I want you to go with John." Yeah. So that as he's on the cross, he kind of closes that loop and says to his mama, "Behold your son." And then to his good friend, "Behold your mother." And from that day, Mary went to live at John's house. You know, later, John moved to Ephesus. I was there about a year and a half ago. You were kind enough to send me on a Footsteps of Paul trip, and I went to Ephesus, and one of the things at Ephesus is Mary's house. John lived at Ephesus, and Mary had a house there. And if you want to, you can go online when you go home. You can just Google Mary's house in Ephesus, and it'll bring up some YouTube videos of it, and you can see it's a really pretty house. But what a lovely, lovely thing. But what do we take away from this? What I think we take away from this is you need to take care of the people you love in the eventuality of your death. You need to take care of the people you love in the eventuality of your death. None of us knows when we're going to die. Almost everybody is always surprised when a family member dies. Even if they have a long illness, one of the first things that seems always to be said was, "Well, we just didn't expect it so soon." And then there are times when people die quite unexpectedly. You want to take care of your family members in the eventuality of your death, because you don't know how long you have to do it. You need to take care of that immediately. You'd be amazed at how many people, how many Americans don't have a will. How many American adults don't have a will? That's astonishing. What are people thinking? You know, are they thinking, "Well, you know, I'm not going to be dying anytime soon, and everybody knows you can't die without a will, so if I don't make a will, I'm not going to be dying yet. It's not time for that." Guess what? You know, the fact that you do not have a will is not going to change that. Maybe you're going to die anyway. And then all you do is you die without a will and you leave your family in enormous turmoil. Do your loved ones a favor. If you don't have a will, get one drawn up this week. Greg Wills? Just about every man in this church has a will that Greg Wills drew up. Wave your hand so we can see you, Greg. Yeah, Greg didn't know I was going to do that to him. But, you know, like, call an attorney or do whatever you need to do to get a will. It is a practical way to take care of your family. And if you are a grown-up, you need a will. If you're not a grown-up, it's okay if you don't have a will. But if you're a grown-up, you need a will. Do that. Second thing about wills is lay your hands on yours this afternoon. Okay, like, go home, eat your lunch, and then just go pull your will out of your file cabinet and lay your hands on it. The reason I say that is I had a will. It was a really great will. I loved that will. It was a great will, right? So when we were about to go on this trip about a year and a half ago, a month ahead of time, I'm like, okay, well, one of the things I need to do to get ready is make sure that, you know, the will is where everybody can find it. And I also want to make sure that my funeral arrangements are the way I want them, because I don't want somebody singing Lord of the Dance at my funeral, you know. I love Lord of the Dance at other people's funeral, but I want, you know, like, oh, hail the power of Jesus' name, right? Well, you got to write that stuff in. And maybe your family will honor your request. It's not that likely, by the way, but they might. So, you know, it's like, if you care about what happens in your funeral, make a few notes about that. But for sure, what I want to ask you to do is, after lunch today, go to wherever you think your will is and lay hands on it. Because you know what? I went to the file cabinet, pulled out where my will was supposed to be, and there was nothing there. I spent my spare time over a couple of days trying to think, where could my will possibly be? I couldn't find it anywhere. You know, if I had died, that would have been inconvenient for my family. Where's the will? I know there's one somewhere. So lay hands on your will, maybe this afternoon. If your will is in your safe deposit box at the bank, go by the bank sometime this week and just check and make sure it's there. Read through it. Make sure it still, you know, says about what you want it to say. That's a very practical way to take care of the people you love. The other thing I want to say about taking care of the people you love is two words: life insurance. Life insurance. Life insurance. Okay, this is what I want to say about life insurance. Life insurance is not needed by everybody. If you're wealthy, and if when you die, your family is going to have uninterrupted access to the money that they need, you probably don't need life insurance. Or if you are so old that the premiums will be more than it's worth, you probably don't want life insurance. Except for those two cases, I want to say to you, you may need some life insurance. And please don't think, well, if I don't have life insurance, that gives me a reason to live, to take care of my family. Look, you got lots of reasons to live, but if you die anyway, do you really want your husband to have to get remarried because somebody's got to take care of the children? That's what I said to Elizabeth when I was getting a life insurance policy on her. She's like, what? This was like, I don't know, 15 years ago. She's like, why would you need to get life insurance on me? I don't work. I said, because baby, we got three children that you take care of. And if something happens to you, somebody's got to take care of these children. And I don't want to have to get married to somebody who can look after these children. So we got to get some life insurance so I can pay somebody to do that. That's why we got a life insurance policy on Elizabeth. Life insurance on me, so that when I get called off to glory, then there'll be a regular stream of income to take care of what I would have been earning. You'd be amazed at how many people in their 30s or 40s that make, I don't know, $50,000, $75,000, $100,000 a year that their family really counts on. Do they have life insurance? Yeah, they got $5,000. Well, what's going to happen to your family? What's going to happen to your family when you die if there's not adequate life insurance to make up for your loss of income? What are they going to do? Is that loving? I don't know. Let me suggest a couple of things to you about this. Go home, Google life quotes, L-I-F-E, life quotes, Q-U-O-T-E-S. Just Google life quotes. It's this company that has a jillion life insurance companies that you can choose from, and you can get the very best policy. You want term life insurance because it's cheap and it'll do the job. So if you don't have enough life insurance, your spouse will probably tell you, okay? If you don't have enough life insurance, get some just as soon as you can, so that when you breathe your last, you're not going, oh no, how's Mary gonna pay the bills? Instead, you're going, oh Jesus, I can't wait to get to heaven, right? Yeah. So there you go. Really practical stuff. We see Jesus at the end of his life taking care of these relationships that are important, providing for the well-being of his mother. So I just invite you to think about how, on the one hand, it's important to support our loved ones as they do whatever it is God is calling them to do, even if you don't agree with that. Just give them loving support. And on the other hand, think about what happens at the end of your life and how you can be ready for that. And by the way, if there's anybody in your family that you're not speaking to, let me suggest that you give them a call this afternoon and act normal. You know, like, hi, Fred. Yeah, I know I haven't spoken to you the last 25 years. You know, like, yeah, we won't start that way. Just, hey, Fred, how are things going? Yeah, it's been a long time, but you know what I mean? Make things right. You don't know when it's coming. Last, make things right with the Lord. The reason Jesus Christ is on this cross is to buy salvation for you and for me, so that we can have forgiveness of our sins here and now, so that we can have God's guidance in our lives here and now, and so that we can go to heaven when we die. If you're not sure that you have a relationship with Jesus Christ that is a saving relationship, make sure. Some things are too important to be left to chance. Make sure. And let me just mention a way you can do that. Give me a call. Give me a text. Email me. Anybody that plays the violin as good as you do, Marie, can cough all they want to. Email me, all right? Or just say on your way out the door, I want to talk to you. And we can talk a little about that and pray. And if you feel like you want to do it right now, you can come up to the altar and we can pray together during the closing hymn. Amen? Amen. Let's have that closing song.
Stand together.
here today, do what you need to do. Alrighty? Do what you need to do when you leave here today. And if you're not sure of your relationship with Jesus Christ, please connect with me, because salvation is too good to wait until the last minute to find out about. Now receive this benediction. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the throne of grace with exceeding joy, unto the only wise God be honor, glory, dominion, and power. And may the love of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and forever. Amen.